Hello and welcome to a special pre-IO episode of Google Maps Developers Live. This week, Brendan, Mano, and I have been joined by Team Instrument, who's working on a map dive exhibit for Google I.O. They're going to give us a demo and introduce themselves, give us a demo, and then we'll talk a little bit about the technology. So with that, Instrument team, do you guys mind let us know what you're working on and who you are?
And I'm a creative director on the project at sort of the labs group here at the Instrument.
And I'm Ben Purdy, and I am a technical lead and have been doing a bunch of the development on this thing.
Yeah, so just a little background about Instrument. We're a small or medium-sized creative agency in Portland, Oregon, and we actually started out as basically purely a dev shop with just a little bit of design farmed out, and it's grown to about 80 people now doing everything from website development to motion graphic and content production. And it's a cool opportunity to be working on this project, particularly since that's what the labs group within Instrument was formed as. So we'd love to show you the demo of the map dabbing. So Ben will go outside and I will try to narrate what he's doing. So what you're seeing right now on the seven big screens here are the attract mode, and Ben will raise his arms to sort of attract Pegman to fly towards him. And now sort of he will raise his arms to so that the Kinect or the ASUS device will recognize him. It will do like a pirouette and then fly over a countdown above the clouds. And that's just to sort of orient the user as to what's going on and let them sort of get a feel for flying. And now the level starts. And so he's diving down towards a zoomable Google map. And the objective of the game is to hit gates and bonus stars. And the way that it works is if you have your arms stretched out, you're planing out and sort of can sort of move vertically in the air. And then as you're, or horizontally, sorry. And then when you move your arms closer to your body, you will dive. And so that's what he's doing right here. And he does a little sort of a loop once he hits a gate and a barrel roll when he hits a star. And every so often, the map will reload to get you closer to the ground, so to speak. And it's super responsive and fun to watch even, and even more fun to play. So we'll let just Ben sort of show his skill. And he purposefully missed an object in space there. People at I.O. will be able to see the bonus rounds that will be. There's 13 base maps that are sort of takes on a normal Google map, and then there's about five bonus modes that are sort of just fun takes and more intense levels that will give you bonus multipliers and more points. So we look forward to showcasing those. And so you see in the distance there sort of a pulsing graphic, and that's kind of the drop zone. And so you're diving over 13 locations in the world, and right now you were over Statue of Liberty in New York. And so he has just managed to hit the drop zone, and we'll initiate the celebration sequence right here. And so that's kind of a cinematic cut sequence. And he will circle the Statue of Liberty, and after a couple seconds, he basically will take off up into the sky again. And that's the basic gameplay. You can miss, and then a parachute will deploy and kind of sort of show you that you weren't quite as good. And then quickly you can get back to it and try again. And so, without further ado, here's Ben sort of describing the magic behind this thing.
All right. So, as you can see, this is a multi-screen experience. I'll just go through really quickly what is driving the actual display and game. So each one of these seven monitors is being run off of a separate PC, and every single one of those is just an instance of Chrome running in full screen. This whole thing is built on JavaScript and web technologies. All of the communication is handled through web sockets, just routing messages through an instance of node.js. So there's no native sort of custom apps running except for the body tracking, which is an Open Frameworks app using OpenNI and a 3D camera, sort of like a Kinect. So that's kind of what's driving this thing. Each of the viewports is basically just showing the current game state, and then we have another PC that is not connected to any of the game displays. There's sort of a podium that you can see in the scene there that is running sort of the game logic, and then game state is sent out to all seven of the displays at about 60 hertz, which is what we try to keep the frame rate at. So it's pretty ambitious for something running completely in Chrome, but it's been a breeze to work with, and the synchronization between the displays has been not much of a problem at all. So that's basically what's driving it. We use the 3JS WebGL library to do all of the 3D objects in the foreground, and the map plane is actually an HTML Google map that's live. There's no trickery going on. It's just being transformed using 3D CSS to stay in sync with the WebGL camera. So what you're seeing is an actual live Google map. If I hadn't turned off the user input, you could actually drag and zoom and pan on the thing. But even though that would sort of distort the game experience, it really is there, really is running. Yeah. So that's been kind of a fun experience trying to marry the 3D CSS with WebGL. Additionally, we had to do some kind of interesting trickery to get the view synchronized. And so what we ended up doing is having sort of a dummy object in 3D space that we attach the actual camera to, and then we just offset the rotation of that camera depending on the view index. And then as long as each viewport is rendering the same scene, and since they're all synchronized over the network, the scene stays in sync. Then once you put the views side by side, everything stitches together. So what I was also going to talk about a little bit was the tools that we had to make to build this thing. And what we ended up doing is building the tool to create levels using, again, it just runs in Chrome, and then we used Google Maps extensively to create this tool. The whole game space is actually tied to real-world coordinates, and so we just have a translation between actual latitude and longitude and our game space. And so that makes it really easy to design these courses, which are laid out at various points over the globe. And so we actually have a Google map where we can just drop items and kind of practice courses and that sort of thing. And so I can walk through the editor here a little bit. You're going to have to forgive my sort of UX-less developer console styling here. And another sort of caveat I must say is that I designed this to work on the touchscreen podium, and so these big fat buttons are as a result of my big fat fingers. So I'll just run through this really quick. Again, this is sort of the behind the scenes, nobody should have to see this poor UI, but what I have here is both the admin console that runs the game, and then the editor actually runs on top of this. So you can switch into edit mode at any time, and it sort of takes over the gameplay. So I've got an instance of the game running on my local machine here. So you can see that my little pigman is not falling because I'm in edit mode right now. And so that lets me to sort of fly around magically so that I can position items and kind of see the layout better. And so in this admin console, I've got a map on the left, which is sort of the overview of the game space. And I've got markers for the player, and I've got markers for gates and items you can pick up and landmarks and that sort of thing. There's a lot of sort of pieces that I've added to make building levels easier, so I can center on items. You can select items from this list that are all of the active entities in the world. Double-clicking on one of those will center it in the view. All of these items are interactive. So one kind of cool thing, at first I was building all the levels just using this top-down view, and that turned out to be really cumbersome because it's really easy to make a level that's unbeatable if you're just doing it from a top-down view. And so eventually I merged the editor, like I said, into the actual game engine. And so with this new system, I'm actually able to try to fit this on my screen here. All of the changes that I'm making are actually sent live to the viewports. So I'm not sure how well the frame rate will translate to this screen share. But you can see that as I'm dragging one of the objects in the map view, the 3D object in the game space is also picking up those changes. And the same thing goes for creating new entities and that sort of thing. So it's been really great to not have to code all of this map drag and drop. And I use things like checking to see if location is within bounds. I have some other sort of niceties to make sure I don't make unbeatable levels, where I can, if I drag the start point for the map around, I get this nice ring that shows me sort of how far the player needs to be from the drop zone to be able to hit it in time, so I don't end up starting the player too far away or too close. And then I'm even using geocoding, so that when we're designing a level, I can just type in the name of a location, and it'll pre-populate some sort of search results text that we end up putting on the screen. So it's been really great, like I said, to not have to reinvent all of these tools to build an application like this. We've been able to just focus on things like the gameplay and the graphics. So
very cool. So you can actually run all this on your laptop then? I mean, you can actually play the game and everything.
Yeah. Oh yeah. I mean, before we had the seven displays, that, you know, we had the game up and running, I can set the viewport dynamically through a little config file, and so I would just literally open seven sort of little tiny, tall, skinny instances of Chrome and line them up across the top of my larger desk monitor, and then I could sort of, you know, simulate what it would be like when the monitors showed up. And then when they showed up, we just got Chrome running on them and fired it up, and it was like basically painless to get this thing working on the actual distributed installation versus just on a single computer.
So it sounds like it's pretty much built all on kind of open technology. So
yeah. Like I said, we're using so it's all running in Chrome. All of the game logic is JavaScript running in Chrome, and then Node.js is running the communications, and it literally is just sort of a hub so that the game logic can broadcast the game messages out to the seven sort of display clients. And then the node also handles routing the control information from the body tracking software, which is just a UDP connection to Node.js, which then sends the body tracking. It's just basically the angle of your torso compared to the ground, and then each arm compared to the torso. So we just get three angles that are being sent to the control node at as fast of a frame rate as the thing can capture. And so then the control node sort of integrates that. I've got a way of normalizing input so I can play off of the keyboard or the body tracking, or I even have a way to simulate body tracking using the mouse cursor. So, but that's built on open frameworks using OpenNI to do the body tracking, which was pretty fun to do some debugging and playing with that. We had a lot of fun trying to work out some of the kinks of having multiple people in the scene at once. We did a lot of like running around in circles with lots of people in the view.
We should show that.
Yeah. Play that back at like 5x speed with a funny soundtrack.
So the most important question right now is really, who's the best player right now?
Oh gosh, I would not want to take on our technical director. He's pretty competitive, and every time I would come around the corner to try to test out, you know, some change, I'd have to kick him off because he'd be there trying to get perfect.
Yeah, I heard when we were chatting with you guys earlier, there's some talk about having a leaderboard. That would be
yeah, we're working on adding some capabilities to do competitive play, just in terms of ability of levels and you know, being able to one up your buddies. So
if not for IO, then maybe for the open source release that we're going to potentially.
Well, yeah, so you guys, so this is obviously going to be at I.O., and you guys are going to be at I.O. You can talk to people about this, which, so I'm sure a number of developers are going to be very interested in the tech stack. Right. But then afterwards, can you talk a little bit about your plans for this afterwards?
Well, the plan right now is that we would like to release the code. It's going to need a little bit of cleanup before that happens. The code base right now is very much tuned to some of the challenges of working on a sort of distributed display. It does work on a single machine, and I don't foresee a lot of integration and refactoring effort required to get this all working within a single instance of Chrome. All I need to do is pull out the code that would be talking to Node.js and just have basically like a dummy message router, and then it should all, I mean, there's nothing that would stop it from being like a single player in a single browser experience at this point.
Oh, great.
Cool.
Great.
We're also hoping that some of the tools that we used for designing levels that Ben created, also like a tool that our other developer, Seb Chevrel, wrote to allow us to design tricks for little Pegman, like barrel rolls and flips and glides and things, that will probably, that'll be the last things we add, but we'd like to show that too in open source as well.
Yeah, there's been a lot of fun little tools and tricks along the way. We actually have full body motion capture that was driving an articulated Pegman at one point. We've got a lot of pretty neat little things that we've had to overcome and play with for this.
Wait, was this so you're doing from like the open frameworks to like actual like motion capture and mapping?
Yeah, because you can get all of the actual joint positions, and so for the gameplay, we're just tracking our arms and that sort of thing. But to create assets, rather than hand animating, we were going to do like full body motion capture of like little pigmans.
So. That's awesome.
Yeah.
Cool. Well, yeah, we don't want to give too much away because, you know, we'll probably have some follow-up shows. You know, maybe after Google I.O. we can do a, kind of a technical deep dive with you guys to talk a little more, you know, maybe look at some
specific APIs. Is released,
And definitely, so for those of you tuning in, if you're going to be at I.O., we definitely hope that you will have a chance to kind of play the map dive. And if not, if you're going to be joining us actually via GDL or IO Extended, we're definitely going to have some more shows. And so hopefully you can kind of join us in spirit. So thanks for joining us, Instrument Team. This is a really awesome kind of.
See you guys in San Francisco.
Yeah.
Sounds good.
And viewers, you know, thanks for joining us and hope to see you soon. Bye-bye.